Rudolf Steiner never visited America, but he did travel extensively in Europe during the last 20 years or so of his life, delivering over 6,000 lectures, as well as writing books, plays, and a collection of meditative verses. Walter Kugler is in charge of the archive related to Steiner's work up until his death in 1925. It's housed in the basement of this building, across the meadow from the Goethe Arnhem in Switzerland, the center of the Anthroposophical Society that Steiner founded. It replaced an earlier wooden building which Steiner designed and worked on with an international group of helpers for nearly 8 years, and which was destroyed by fire on New Year's Eve in 1922. Steiner drew up plans for the replacement, this time made not out of wood, but of concrete. But he never lived to see its completion. What did survive the fire was this huge carving which Steiner created along with the English sculptor Edith Marion and known as the Group. Steiner referred to the central figure as the representative human being. In some people's eyes, it's an imagination of what St. Paul proclaimed, not I, but the Christ in me. The carving is also a depiction of the two polarities that Steiner saw as key ingredients at work in human nature. One, that he identified as Lucifer, is the influence that gives us our sense of self, independence, and creative potential. But if taken to extreme, leads to pride, selfishness, and a flight from our tasks on Earth. The other influence, Steiner called this being Ahriman, is what helps us to keep our feet on the ground and to live in the here and now. But again, if taken to extreme, encourages us to believe that only what can be weighed, counted, and measured is real. All else is fantasy. Our task is to hold these two polarities in balance. And Steiner didn't leave out the role of humor on this arduous journey. Jung would have called Lucifer and Ahriman archetypes. For Steiner, they were actual beings, beings like us, caught up in a mighty evolutionary drama, and a drama that is unfolding not just in the heavens, but throughout human history here on Earth.
It's a drama that has consequence for the spiritual world, and it is not just a kind of forgettable backdrop to what really counts. It's not something simply to transcend as a as Maya, as an illusion, as something that you want to get out of in order to go to heaven and avoid hell or something like that. He has much more the sense that human evolution and human history are part of a grand spiritual drama that transcendent, you know, beings and forces and realities are attending to and are in some sense participating in and are interested in the consequences of. That's extraordinary.
But in these last years of his life, Steiner was not only occupied with his visions of cosmic and human evolution, and with the creation of new architectural and sculptural forms, inspiring artists such as Kandinsky and Joseph Beuys. Despite problems with his health, he continued to travel, here on a visit to North Wales in 1923. By then, he was increasingly concerned about the situation emerging in the aftermath of the First World War, politically, socially, and economically.
He feels that humanity is in a great battle, and he's trying to help, really trying to save evolution from the dead end.
Or one-sidedness.
One-sidedness is a dead end. If it's unbalanced, it will break, it will crash, and it will bring terrible suffering. Well, see, Steiner feels we have already been through terrible suffering. There is terrible suffering in the world, cruelty. People, you know, starving, that's an unbalance. So he's very interested in economics, and in the proper way for a government and a community to form in order to really to save people from starvation and also from meaningless work. Great concern. He's not a Marxist, but he drank from that cup. He knew that Marx's critique of capitalism has some profound truth to it. It's a cruel system. Totalitarianism is also cruel. We haven't found an uncruel system, but that's what he was looking for, where the economic, the political, and then the whole cultural sphere would work collaboratively in their respective spheres without anyone taking over the other. But in the West, but particularly in the United States, the economic, of course, is just far more powerful than the other spheres, controlling education, even religion. This is, for him, this is a great, great concern.
Economics points to banking. And the concern expressed by Steiner nearly 100 years ago and echoed by Robert McDermott that the economic sphere has got too big for its boots has increasingly become the concern of many. Here in London, at the client day of the UK branch of the Dutch-based Triodos Bank, are both customers and bankers who are trying to work in a different way with money. Greater transparency, greater responsibility, and greater consciousness of how the money deposited is actually used. Peter Blom is chairman of the executive board of Triodos Bank.
I'm convinced that banks should look more at what is really needed in society and then make out of that a feasible business. And then you need some profit, of course. You cannot do without profit, but you don't start with profit. Profit is the result. And I think that was also something what relates strongly to what Steiner always said. Profit is not something you aim for. Profit is something what is a sign of a healthy operation. It's emerging from a healthy transaction. And that is a much better way of looking at profit than putting it there as a goal, as an objective, and make everything work for that goal. With Steiner, he always had the human being in the back of his mind when he was talking about economics, about medicine or whatever. And that is an important element what we can learn about, because most of the thinking now, we exclude the human being. It's about the system, and the human being should fit into the system. And what he did is was saying, well, let's take each human being as a starting point. Let's design something around that, what can work to serve human beings. And that deeper principle, I think, is quite important. And you cannot achieve that by just copying what he has said or just repeat what he has said. I think that's the challenge, maybe not so much for him, but for us to work with what he has brought to us.
What Steiner brought was frequently in response to questions and to requests from individuals or professional groups, teachers, farmers, priests, artists, and doctors. In April 1921, he gave a three-week lecture course for a group of medical practitioners in Dornach, his base in Switzerland, during which he gave the first detailed and systematic introduction to anthroposophic medicine, and also spoke about mistletoe as a remedy for cancer. The essence of all such gatherings was the quest for a deeper understanding of the human being, without which, said Steiner, it has actually become impossible to investigate the true nature of health and disease. Steiner worked closely with the Dutch doctor, Ita Wegman, in bringing his insights about health and disease into practical application. At the Hiske Institute in nearby Arlesheim, research into the use of mistletoe as a treatment for cancer continues. Into this high-tech machine, the sap from mistletoe, harvested in June, is mixed with the sap from a second harvest in winter. The rotating discs revolving at an incredible 10,000 cycles per minute, a velocity of 1,600 kilometers per hour. One of the doctors had described to me how mistletoe, this semi-parasitic plant with no inclination to be a proper plant, with roots in the earth and a normal flowering process, could be seen as somehow held back in an embryonic way.
To me, this exposure of the saps to such gravitational forces, I mean, 50,000 G forces, is like a huge wake-up call to a mistletoe potential, bringing it to Earth by exposing it to these gravitational forces. And that seems the key to unlocking the potential of the mistletoe for the treatment of cancer, unlocking it by bringing it to gravity.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's just another way of my way of describing
absolutely
it. Because that was, I think, behind Steiner's attempt to unlock potential. Yeah. The mistletoe is a hidden plant until it becomes unlocked in this way, the manufacturing process, and then in clinical practice.
Yeah.
I asked the director at Hiskia about this strange combination of highly sophisticated technology with a plant one associates with druids and folklore.
Yeah, the combination is strange. This old, huge, old mystical plant and this high-tech procedure. But, you know, these are polarities which maybe give sense.
Which may be taken as a feature, as a characteristic of anthroposophic medicine, both trying to span the understanding based on old traditional insights, but accompanied now with the rigor of modern natural science and bringing it down to literally to earth and gravity.
Outside the institute, the botanist at Hiskia showed me an example of mistletoe growing in an oak tree, describing what he called its anti-tendency to all the normal processes of plant growth.
It has a very strong reduced shoot growth. Every season you have only one stem and two leaves and no more leaves. And the next season they will open the flower, and in the end of the season the berries will ripen. So it has a very strongly reduced shoot growth. And through that, that's what Steiner pointed out. It is collecting forces, powers, and as we know today, also building up substances which have a potential in the cancer therapy.
Because Maurice, I mean, you're a doctor. You use this mistletoe. What actually is it doing? It's not a cure for cancer, is it?
Steiner introduced it in 1921, publicly in one of his lectures, as a potential medicament that could help cancer treatment. Not, as you said, necessarily as a cure, but research has shown there have been many cases collected already where cancer with mistletoe treatment alone can have quite a powerful effect, and some patients even go into remission. Mostly, over the last research has shown, and Helmut already indicated, the substances have been looked at and studied in great detail now, and more is now understood of why this may be the case, why it may be a helpful remedy.
Why is it?
Well, it's something to do with its peculiar botanical properties and the very unique composition of substances inside. And the most studied substances, I mean, there are hundreds of different substances inside, but the most that have been studied and are understood are the lectins and the viscotoxins, two substances that seem to have a direct impact on the cancer and, equally important, an impact on the immunity, the patient's immunity, the possibility of one's own natural forces to deal with and, to an extent, overcome cancerous processes.
Yeah. Pollution, stress, illness. How can we find the ability to muster inner forces in the healing process, or simply to cope with modern life? An ally in this challenge is Valida UK, here on the outskirts of Ilkeston in Derbyshire. Founded in 1921 as a result of Steiner's contact with the medical profession, Valida is now a worldwide organization providing medicines that stimulate our natural capacity to heal ourselves and to remain healthy. It also creates products which, in Valida's words, restore harmony and enhance well-being. Alongside its modern and efficient production line, many of the substances are potentized by hand, enhancing, so they believe, the efficacy of the medicines. The managing director is Bob Ballard.
I think there's a general disillusionment with the one-size-fits-all standardization, normalization. And I think there's a greater awareness of people's own responsibilities for their own actions and their own, in our business, health and well-being, yeah. There's so many side effects with a lot of the conventional medicines. Not all, but there's a lot of side effects because of this one-dimensional view of the human being, you know, as a machine. And if something breaks, you just fix it, yeah? Without a total awareness of what's the implications of that on the rest of the body, yeah? Yeah, yeah. Well, oh, mind and spirit, yes. Yeah.
The plants that are used in the majority of Valida's remedies are grown in their own biodynamic garden. The space is deliberately not all geared to production, but to the health and diversity of the environment as a whole, a pond, meadow and trees. For Michael Bate and his assistant Claire Hattersley, the plants, all plants, mirror aspects of the human being. And if recognized, are there to restore balance and to heal.
The medicines which Rudolf Steiner himself gave us are very fascinating. And when you really study the growth and gestures of the plants that he suggested, they can provide this picture often of the healthy working of, say, the heart or the liver or whatever. Or, on the other hand, provide a mirror of how that organ or that system doesn't work.
This commitment to ponder deeply on Steiner's sometimes challenging indications about our relationship to nature and to our interconnectedness with nature, and to observe what the plant is saying to us, is at the heart of Valida's work. Michael also spoke to me about the challenge of being as fluid and flexible as nature herself, and to recognize that everything, including our own lives, is in process. Nothing is fixed. And like each one of us, every plant has its own unique signature.
We have some plants here that they almost push us away. They don't really want us to interfere too much with the way they grow. They don't really want to respond to us gardening and cultivating them. They would rather be standalone. And there are other medicinal plants that are quite kind of, they don't change too much if we are weeding them and hoeing them. And you get a sense that they are working with us. But there are certain plants that are much more independent. And if we start to fuss them too much, then they're perhaps not so happy.
Yeah.
So we have to respect that as well.
What's your understanding? What's the definition of a weed, then?
A plant in the wrong place. I see weeds very differently now since I've worked at Valida.
Something that's very difficult to grow if you want to.
Really?
Yeah.
Quite often the plants we're trying to cultivate, sometimes they just turn their nose up. They won't behave themselves like garden plants. They're not predictable, so we'll sow a bed of something, maybe poppies, and they won't come up, but maybe in 3 years' time they'll come up for us. So we have to be a little bit kind of flexible.
I think your plants sound to me more and more like people.
Yes,
yes.
People, their health and well-being, are the prime concern of the Blackthorn Medical Centre at Maidstone in Kent, an NHS practice that combines conventional medicine with an anthroposophical approach to health and healing. It also offers therapies that include eurythmy, biographical counselling, rhythmic massage and art. In addition, the Blackthorn Trust has a contract with social services for the rehabilitation of patients with mental health problems through work in Blackthorn's garden, bakery, cafe and craft workshop. The practice also has NHS funding for their work on pain management. David McGavin, like all good doctors, is enthusiastic about helping people who, for various reasons, feel themselves at the end of the road. Sometimes only then can the healing begin.
And that's what we have to do. And that's what is such fun doing. Because the human being is so resourceful. There is so much talent there. People come in feeling that they are so shallow. They come in feeling that they are nobody because of the way they've been treated, because of the way they've been reduced, because they have nothing now in terms of income. They've lost their car, they're on benefits. They feel they're that big. They've no idea, until they start working, of the depths of their humanity. Others see it. Those who love them see it. But they've lost the sense of that. The body is not the machine. It's filled with wonders and abilities of which the conscious human being is using a fraction. And it's in these circumstances of chronic pain, in a way the torture of the illness, with no material way of getting out of it, that one is thrown into this mysterious world. And to have Rudolf Steiner's maps, as it were, is a great help.
The Goethe Arnhem in Switzerland, location for the annual International Medical Conference for Anthroposophical Practitioners, at which David McGavin is one of the speakers.
And the latest plan, because we have plans every 2 or 3 years, is that the money will now go to doctors, and we will have all the money.
We have chosen patients who are not just difficult, but difficult to treat. And so we all fight with each other because we all know best. But with these patients, they are so difficult. We all needed each other. And if you have a big problem and you don't know what to do, they become very interested in you. If you want to try, you only have to try.
Какие еще люди могут нам помочь?
And the whole thing goes into a very, very expensive form of amusement. Everybody wants more.
And this is a real problem.
And I think our medicine is one of the very few, if not the only medicine, that can take patients into independence because we recognize the presence of the ego.
There are nearly 3,000 doctors worldwide who've taken the additional training in anthroposophic medicine. Alongside an increasing number of hospitals, clinics and surgeries offering treatments informed by and developed from Rudolf Steiner's indications. Ursula Flatters qualified as a doctor in her native Germany, but has worked in Sweden for 30 years and was a co-founder of the Vida Clinic in Jana. I asked her what she felt was Steiner's most significant contribution to medicine.
It's very much. Maybe the most important thing is that you need to integrate every illness into the biography of a human being. It means the illness has a context and that has big moral consequences. You have to treat everybody individually. You have to listen to everybody. You have to find out what is the possibility in this situation for the individual patient. Maybe this is the strongest thing. That inspired me most and really deeply changed my relationship to the patients and my decision making.
So each person has a story in a way, that's what you're saying.
Yes, yeah? Yes, and the story is sometimes a secret story even for the patient. So when you get ill, something is like a secret. There's something in it that we both have to find out.
Steiner said everybody has a mission, not only the big person on the platform. Everybody has a mission that also means he has a task in this life. So this kind of feeling for biographies as a period of time in which we come with task and we work for this task and we go with the results and bring the results in the future evolution of ourselves, but also of humanity.
Michaela Glöckler worked as a pediatrician in Germany before becoming head of the medical section at the Goetheanum.
Steiner's concept of spirituality is that every human thought is a spiritual power. That what you think will be reality of tomorrow. That thinking is not just a cloudy thing. That thinking is the driver of evolution. So if you have this concept, thinking is the spiritual power and is also life. Then you understand psychosomatics, why thinking can heal, why meditation is healthy, why bad thoughts are affecting people. You do not know this only, you understand, and you can also work with that concretely in healing, in concepts. But also when you have remedies from nature, minerals, plants, healing plants, you understand the spirit, you understand the effect also on the consciousness, on various parts of the body. So we study very concretely, very scientific, what works in the nature and corresponds with nature processes in our physical nature. And on the other hand, what can we contribute by helping the people to live more consciously, more meaningful, more healthily in all their various life circumstances.
Michael Evans is a general practitioner from England who also runs regular courses in anthroposophic medicine for doctors in the UK and in India and the Philippines.
I think what's unique about Steiner's contribution is that on the one hand, he fully recognized what conventional medicine was offering as a detailed knowledge of the physical body, but made it very clear and almost challenged doctors to think beyond the box and to be aware that the human being has life forces, has a soul, has a spiritual identity, and that all that is part of being human, and really all that is involved in the process of becoming ill and potentially can be mobilized in the healing process.
Karina Zeller is from Argentina and works as a doctor in Chile.
I was always very interested in spirituality, and I had the experience both the science and the spirituality are truth. And both are truth, but I can't find the bridge. And there has to be a bridge.
Science and spirituality.
Yeah, because I was always very interested in science too. And I was searching, looking for the bridge, and I couldn't find it. And I read a book of Rudolf Steiner in Ita Wegmann, and I said, here is the bridge that I'm looking for.
Are you optimistic about the future and medicine?
One of the things that people have said about anthroposophic medicine is that it's the medicine for tomorrow. I suspect it's the medicine for the day after tomorrow. So it needs really the long view. So I'm optimistic in the long view. not quite so optimistic in the short term.
Do you see an element of tragedy in Steiner's life, the fact that he did die quite early?
Early, yes. Certainly, I think the whole life is, from one point of view, it's a tragedy. I think he was suffering a very lot.
Because
I think his insights were so far-reaching that he didn't meet enough people to understand quick enough. But from another point of view, you can say love is always a tragedy. You come with something really new. It was really an impulse of love, I think. So it must fail in a way to begin with, looks like that, because he was not the big star. He connected to people, he wanted to work with people, he took them as they were. He was positive, and all this very big social impulse it's great. Maybe it's a little bit more slow for him, but we all are invited to this, and that is not a tragedy. I think that's beautiful. It takes some time, but it's beautiful that he chose that. He could have gone to the mountains and wrote a lot of wonderful books, but he chose to work together with people. And it's very great. I don't know anything else that is so practical, that really tries to create a culture from spiritual insights, not only having them, but doing something. But things are going much slower than one would wish. Even in me, I'm too slow, I'm too lazy.
Slowly but surely might be one way to describe the progress of Rudolf Steiner's legacy, not only in medicine, but in all areas of daily life. He died nearly 100 years ago, on March the 30th, 1925. During his lifetime, he frequently spoke about death, and in particular about the bond that continues between those of us on Earth and those who are no longer physically present. And to the extent that we are open and aware of those we have known and loved, so can they continue to help and inspire us. And we, in our turn, can communicate to them insights and experiences that can only be learned in the here and now. The essence of his message, as I understand it, a message that tries to communicate ancient wisdom in a form appropriate for modern consciousness, is that there is only one world, part seemingly hidden, part revealed, and that we human beings are not alone, not just in our daily lives, but in the universe at large. Thank you.
I suppose the challenge with Steiner is to find ways of bringing what I think is his remarkable contribution more into mainstream life. He's very largely neglected in academic circles, and I can understand the reasons for that, but I still think he's a very interesting and important thinker, and I'd like to find ways in which he could be brought more into academic study. I'd also like to see ways in which his practical initiatives can become integrated into the ordinary fabric of society more than they have been. I mean, he has been rather too much a kind of specialist, almost cult figure for a small minority. But there's nothing new about this. I think in many ways that was a problem that he faced in his own lifetime, and he was almost 40 before he found any significant audience for the things he wanted to say. And there were always problems, I think, in finding an appropriate audience, and the audience he did find, largely growing out of the Theosophical Society, were perhaps looking for slightly different things than he wanted to give. I think there was always something of a tension there.
What were they looking for?
Well, I think those early members of the Theosophical Society were looking for a wisdom teacher who would tell them how things were. And Steiner could do that, but he was also someone who developed this philosophy of freedom, philosophy of spiritual activity, and as he so often emphasized, didn't want people to accept things simply because he told them they were so, but wanted to explore things for themselves, to find their own path. So I think there was quite a disjunction between the kind of great leader that his followers were looking for and the kind of leader that he wanted to be. A very non-authoritarian leader, I think, is what he believed in being. That's what he thought was appropriate for the modern times in which he was living. I think there may have been sometimes a slightly controlling aspect to his personality that was at variance with what he thought was appropriate and necessary, but on the whole, it's what he thought was necessary that won through, rather than his sometimes controlling instincts.
For me, at least, the way that Steiner is most a part of my own thinking is he opens for me new possibilities that I hadn't considered before, but that are immensely fruitful to pursue. So it's not, I don't approach Steiner as an authority, that because he says this, therefore I know it's true. Instead, I see him sort of radically expanding the areas that I can look at. Reading Steiner or some of his interpreters, I felt like my vision on the world was much narrower, where now I can open to there's a whole number of different areas, all these different rooms I never knew existed that are very much worth thinking about. And some of them I don't know what to do with, and I just let them pass. I'm not all that concerned to try to refute Steiner. I mean, who needs to, right?
As I was saying about the Van de Graaff generator...
One often tries to imagine what would Steiner's life and hopes be like today or in the near future, you know. Imagine him returning, reincarnating, if you will. Would he acknowledge the society he created, or would he have something very different in mind? You know, I think there are a couple of ways of coming at the question. One is to say, to whom was Steiner directing his hopes, his aspirations, his efforts, and it was to humanity. It was not to a small community of anthroposophists. You know, when he started the Waldorf schools, he did not start them for a few tenths of thousands of students, which is what we have now. He had an idea and a vision of the effects of his interventions in education as affecting every child. So there are 45 million school children in the United States. We've got 100 schools, Waldorf schools. Say each of them's got 300 students, you know, so you've got 30,000 students. You have 45 million other students. So it was never meant to be an enclosed community of practice or of belief or anything of that sort. It was meant to be a way of envisioning and understanding the world, oneself, that was to have the broadest possible impact, an impact that would help human beings generally.
The essence of his message is, and this is why it's somewhat difficult to communicate it, is essentially that we already, here and now, as we are, live in a spiritual world.
Steiner challenged us to take our own thinking very, very seriously. He challenged us to think way beyond the logical framework of what's inside the box, but to make connections in our thinking which we could continually test. The challenge of Steiner is to uphold the freedom of the individual human being and to awaken in each of us a sense of our responsibility for the, not just for the future of the planet physically, but for the evolution of this matrix in which we find ourselves, this firmament, as Shakespeare called it, to evoke a sense not just of connectedness, but of co-responsibility. And in the challenge of that path, we have to meet also our own limitations and our own potential for evil. We have to meet, in other words, our own freedom. We can't just replicate what we've been told, but something has to be reborn in us because we will it so, because we think it so. I think that's perhaps the ultimate challenge, to help to bring human beings to the point where we can sit round a table together and say our collaboration is in the service of the universe as we know it. We can change, we can make a difference. And he's given us a unique set of tools to approach that if we resonate with them and take them up.
You haven't used the word God.
This universe that we live in is God. I don't want to postulate. I don't want to postulate a hypothetical God, but the material world of which we are part is in its essence divine substance. I mean, that Steiner was quite clear about. Substance, silica, calcium, magnesium, carbon. These are the clothing of the body of God. And God is that being through which all these substances find their ultimate sublimation. God created the substances, and they've come to rest just for a short while in order that human beings can find their freedom in relationship to them. And I think at some future point, we will all go into a kind of process together again. The world that we know won't be here in this form forever. How can it be if it's in evolution? You know, the sun's life is limited, the earth's life is limited, but does it all stop when the outer manifestation falls away? This is the ultimate existential question for human beings, isn't it? Can you disidentify from the manifestation and still retain a connection to the sense of being? And I think for many people, God is that sense of being.